DNA is the code that makes us, from cheetahs to killer whales to Don Rickles. That code is our genotype, the order of the DNA sequence. The traits that the code results in, what we see, is the phenotype. DNA is coiled up into bunches called chromosomes. Humans have 23 pairs, or 46 different chromosomes. Why do we call them pairs of chromosomes? It's because, for the most part, both chromosomes of a pair code for the same things and have the same genes on them. A gene is a certain stretch of DNA that codes for a given protein or trait. Some traits are controlled by a single gene, like earwax consistency. Others are controlled by multiple genes, like hair color. But each chromosome of the pair will code for the same things. So like here and here will both be the gene for earwax consistency, but they're different versions of that gene. Maybe one allele makes your wax more liquid, and the other allele makes your earwax more solid. An allele is a different form of a given gene. So in this example, we have the gene for earwax consistency with two versions or two alleles of that gene. A metaphor can help explain. Let's say your genome, all your DNA, is a car. A car is made up of all these different parts. These parts are your genes. A gene is just a section of DNA, like a car part is a section of a car, but there are different versions of each car part. Each specific version is an allele. This hubcap is different than this hubcap, but these are all hubcap parts. These are all genes for the same thing. These are the genes for earwax consistency, and this allele leads to solid earwax. This metaphor would probably make more sense if I compared your genome to the blueprints for a car, with the gene just being a drawing for a part, and then you are the car, but moving on. One of each pair of chromosomes was from each of your parents, and your children will be a random mix of your chromosomes and your mate's chromosomes. A random assortment of one of each pair from you, and a random assortment of one of each pair from your mate. And then your grandchildren will be a mix of your child's chromosomes and their mate's chromosomes. They'll have, on average, about a quarter of your chromosomes, a quarter of your genes. On average, because it's a random assortment of your child's genes and your grandchildren. So it could be that your grandchild just happens to have none of your genes, or it could just so happen that your grandchild has half of your genes, that is, all the genes that you gave to your child. So let's say Barack Obama made a baby with Halle Berry. They both have a parent of African descent and a parent of white people descent. There is a chance, although a very small chance, of them producing a sperm or an egg that only contains the chromosomes of one of their parents. If they each made one and they happened to come together, then they could produce an offspring of entirely African descent, or vice versa, an offspring of entirely white people descent. Okay, back to your genes. For all intents and purposes, both chromosomes are producing proteins at the same time. Even though members of the same pair code for the same things, they're both active at the same time. But it may be that only one allele is conveying the phenotype, the traits, if those alleles have a complete dominance relationship. For example, whether a pea seed is wrinkled or smooth is controlled by one gene with two different alleles. We'll call these alleles big S and little s. When you have two big S alleles, you get smooth peas, and when you get two little s alleles, you get wrinkled peas. But when you get a big S and a little s together, you get smooth peas. So it seems that the big S allele is dominant and the little s allele is recessive. Because the phenotype of big S and big S little s is different from the little s. This is called complete dominance, where the phenotype of the mixed allele individual is indistinguishable from the two dominant allele individual. It's as though the phenotypic effects of the little s are being ignored or deleted. It's not that the dominant allele is always better or always worse. This is just one of the ways the genes influence the trait. But what you get is that the big S little s genotype, while expressing the smooth P phenotype, is a carrier for the wrinkled phenotype. If two big S little s individuals got together and got their pollination on, you could get any random mixture of their chromosomes. Remember, these alleles are on different chromosomes. So when these parents breed, you can get any combination of one of each of their pairs of chromosomes. So you can get all these genotypes, which lead to these phenotypes. So even though the parents have the smooth phenotype, they can produce offspring that have the wrinkled phenotype. I don't think the wrinkled peas are any better or worse at being peas, but sometimes the recessive trait can be detrimental. This is one of the reasons why inbreeding, making offspring with close family, is often shunned or illegal. These genes that might lead to hazardous traits, which might not be very common in the population, are expressed when close family produce offspring. The DNA sequence, the order of the nucleotides, codes for all the proteins that make up us and our cells. The sequence can change by things like random mutations, mistakes in the way it's copied that lead to different proteins being made, or from mixing genomes like with sexual reproduction. These are some of the ways our blueprints can change. This is how things evolve. To understand why things evolve, let's first look at why things